So let me continue with the invariant manifolds. And now I talk about smoothness. But just before that, I'd like to give another existence of invariant manifold. In the center, but which is a bit different from what we discussed in the morning, it allows to reduce the dimension of the system. Of the ambient dimension. So here, F is C1. K is invariant and compact. And so the CRM is like that. So CRM C. So it was a CRM we did with Christian Bonatti. So assume there is a partially hyperbolic decomposition with an unstable. So there is a strong and stable manifold now at any point of K. And we wonder if this set is contained in a sub-manifold, a unique one, which would be tangent to EC. So we say K is contained in sigma submanifold tangent to EC, and we would like also sigma to be invariant. We don't know that. It's very similar to the case of Blake. We just have a local invariance. So, and locally invariant. So locally invariant means there is a neighborhood of K, so that U, the intersection of U with sigma, has an image contained in sigma. So for U neighborhood of K, so we have this set. We don't know how it is, and we would like to put it in a submanifold sigma. So here, EC is here, right? It's two-dimensional, and transversally, we would have the strong and stable manifold. Okay, so this is possible if and only if, for any point in K, the strong and stable manifold of the point intersect K only at the point itself. So to show this direction, it is an exercise. And for this direction, I won't do it, just to say that. So we assume this condition. So if you think that the strong and stable leaves gives you some coordinate, you're saying that your set is a graph over this coordinate. So you have first a geometrical part which tells that K is kind of graph transverse to EU. So there is, using that, you know there is a submanifold containing K, but maybe not invariant. And so then to make it invariant, you use a graph transform argument. to get local invariance. So it's a C1 submanifold. So we will use this result later. Okay, so let me talk now about smoothness. So there are two things to discuss. Since we built leaves, it's the smoothness of the leaves themselves and then the transverse smoothness. So first, the leaves. So as I said, if you just consider plaques, in general, they are not C2, even if the diffeomorphism is smooth. On the other hand, for the stable manifold, the strong stable, it was smooth. It was CK, the diffeomorphism is CK. So why this difference? Because there is a property. So in here, let's come back to the setting we had for plaques. So a domination. And we say that E is K dominated. If, so there are C and lambda, such that for any point and any positive iterate, so remember, domination gives you this condition. So K domination require the same with an exponent, but you want to keep domination, so you also require the usual domination. So you have this condition. So the result, so theorem B was about the plaque. Now you have a B prime, which says that if F is CK and E is K dominated, then one can choose a plaque to be CK. And they vary, and they depend continuously on the point X and F, the diffeomorphism, for the CK topology. So this is for the plaque. We have an assumption to fulfill to have the CK smoothness. But now, if E is uniformly contracted, then this quantity here at least if N is large enough is smaller than this one. So it's always satisfied. You always have K domination. So E is K dominated for any K. So just FCK gives you CK leaves. So how to check that? And how appear this condition? I will explain it maybe not for any set K. I will take a particular case, but which is in practice, it's it covers many cases. So I will assume that K is a lamination. So a simpler setting, K is a lamination. So we know that by definition, at through any point there exists a leaf, some manifold tangent to E, but the whole this whole manifold is contained in K. So K is a union, an invariant union, an union of invariant leaves, meaning a leaf is sent to a leaf, tangent to E, and complete, and disjoint. Locally, you think you have something like that. And the leaves are C1. But that depends only continuously in the C1 topology. So for instance, if K is a whole manifold, we have, and if E, well, if K is a whole manifold, I have a foliation. And a foliation. Or another example is K is a submanifold compact boundaryless containing M, and it's a unique leaf. Submanifold tangent to EC. Okay. So to prove the smoothness, we will do it in two steps. So the first step is to check that the tangent space vary Lipschitz. So Lipschitz dependence of E. So if the diffeomorphism is only C1, it's possible to build example where the bundle E only varies continuously. So we only need to have some smoothness. So proposition, assume F is CK, K larger than 2. And that E is at least 2 dominated, then the conclusion is that the map X then EX is Lipschitz when restricted to a leaf of K, it's a lamination.
Stefan, I have some request for some larger font.
Okay. For the larger font. Okay. From the back, here also? Maybe that's possible. So if you don't restrict to a leaf, assume for instance you have a dominated splitting on the whole manifold, the bundle E, in general, is only holder with a constant which depends on the domination, for instance. So here, you get better because you're restricted to a leaf and you have some assumption. So to explain that, there is a computation which is the same as this morning, more or less. So let's try to do it in a correct way. This morning, I'm sorry, I iterated in the wrong direction. So the main idea which will be used many times is this. You take at a point, so you have EX, and now take another direction, another plane close to EX, And you iterate by f, by df. And along the direction E, the cones are not contracted, they will be expanded. And you want to bound this expansion. So of, let's say, the angle between E and E prime. Okay? So to do that, to measure the difference, you take a unit vector here, U, and above U, you take a transverse vector, so along in the transverse cone, V, and now you iterate, and so you have, so dfn of U and dfn of V. And so the expansion is the size of dfn of V normalized by dfn of U. And you want to bound, so you have norm of dfn along F over minimal norm of dfn along E. Okay? Times norm of V over norm of U. So this quantity bounds, yes, the expansion. I want, sorry, again. I want to have, to bound from below. So I take the co-norm. This quantity bounds the expansion of df close to in the future. Hmm? So you may do the same, but in the past, what you have is that the cone is get shrink, and so you have a contraction, and so dfn, f minus n contracts by, well, this quantity. Which is, so if you have graphs, this morning I had graph, and the graph get, when you want to see how graph, the distance between graph is contracted, it's exactly the same computation, exactly this quantity that you have. Okay. So what about the Lipschitz dependence now? So you pick 2 points. You want to compare Ex and Ey. So you don't know. You want to look at their distance in some sense. And in fact, you will compare to the distance to the image. So this is dF minus n of EFn of x and dF minus n of EFn of y at Fn of x, sorry for the font, Fn of y. So this is bounded by, you look to the distance df minus n of at Fn of E Fn of x, and the same at EFn of y, but here you take the same map, inner map, plus something else, which is, well, the difference between the two inner map. Maybe I do it just for one iterate. I will repeat it after. So at f of x and df minus 1 at f of y. Okay? So what we get is, here I see how the cone, because I take a same map, how the cone is contracted by backward iteration, so I see this quantity. Minimal norm. Times the distance now between E at f of x and E at f of y. Plus, now I use that we are C2, so a constant times the distance between f of x and f of y. And then here we repeat, we can iterate more. And so what appears is something like that. So there are a sum of such quantity plus a sum of a term here, which is like, well, let me, oops. Yes. I have product of norm, but okay. Let me. Something like that. Time the distance between E at fn of x, E at fn of y. So this gets exponentially small, plus something which is a sum of this term time. So if it appears after the k step, I have a k power k here. So dfg over e after time g. Okay, distance between f g of x and f g of y. Good. But this distance is bounded by the norm of df g. So if I just want to understand the dependence of E in the whole manifold, here I just have the norm of dfg. So the largest norm is along F. And so I may find a condition to have a Lipschitz dependent on the bundle on the whole manifold, but here I just want along the leaves. The leaves are tangent to E, so here I have E. So I have a sum here, and I want something distance between x and y. So I disregard this term, and what I have here is something time the distance between x and y, and here I want something bounded to have the Lipschitz. So I want this sum to converge, and so this happens if this term gets exponentially small. So what we want is, so this term appears twice. Over this term. And we want that to be exponentially small. So it should be, I erase the two domination. It is a two domination. Okay? So we are Lipschitz. So to get more now, there is a second part, which is an induction argument. To show that we are CK, we reduce to a situation where, with a K minus 1 bunching of something, which is CK minus 1, and then let's see. So induction argument. So we have to look to another dynamics related to this one, which is a lift of this dynamics on the Grassmannian bundle. So I take L, the dimension for the space I consider, so of the fiber E. And so the Grassmannian is, so the space of linear subspaces of Tm with dimension L. So if L is 1, if this dimension is 1, it's just the unit tangent bundle, projective. And so on this space, you may act, you have the action of the tangent map to F. Which is semi-conjugate to the action of F here. So here F is CK, this map here is CK minus 1. And here, so you have the set K with a bundle E. So at each point of K, you look to the fiber here. The fiber is a space of L-dimensional spaces at these points. There is one particular, it is E. At a point X, you have EX, which project to X. And since this bundle is invariant, the collection of EX, so E seen above, defines an invariant compact set which lifts K. And so the lemma tells you that you still have a domination on this set. So this invariant compact set, let's call it lambda. So lambda has a dominated splitting. Where I have to precise, there could be several ones, where the dimension of E is equal to the dimension of E. Okay? It's L. So to show that, proof to do it. Precisely, you need to check a confield criterion. But let me just do a picture. So here, at the point X, you have two directions, E and F. And above, so at a point here, you add some direction which correspond to the fiber. But the fibers are invariant by DF. Okay, so what you add, if you compare to the action of F, is new collection of invariant direction, and so this here bundle is a bundle which lifts E here. And then to check that you have a domination, you have to check that what you add, so F should be something which lifts F, adding the fiber. So to check the new domination, you have to check that the fiber dominates E. So the dynamics in the fiber of your bundle dominate E. Okay, but in the fiber it's just saying I fix a point and I change the space close to E, so it's just to see how DF expands the angle close to E, of the space close to E. So the expansion in the fiber, it's what I computed before, is bounded from below by this quantity, which is minimal norm, if I iterate n time along F, over norm along E, whereas the contraction along E is bounded, well, by TFNE. So to check the domination, you have to check that this quantity is strictly larger than this one, but it's just the two domination here. Of E. Okay? One more thing is that now the new E is K minus 1 dominated. Well, so E lifts E below. E below was K dominated by F. So you have to check what you have added, the fibers. So you just compare this quantity to this quantity. So to check the K minus 1 domination, you just have to say that here, contraction along E times K minus 1 is strictly less than this. Okay? But this is no more than nothing else than the K domination that you have assumed. So you did an induction, you started from something CK with a K domination, and you have built something CK minus 1 with a K minus 1 domination. So by induction now, E let me say one more thing. Now, let's remember that K is a lamination, so collection of leaves, and if you lift those leaves, the lift of a leaf,
lift of a leaf,
is a graph over the leaf. Okay?
The lift of a leaf is a graph over a leaf.
And this graph is Lipschitz. Lipschitz, just because of what we have checked. So it was the first lemma, the proposition. And now you have, so you have a collection of Lipschitz graph, which is invariant. So you have a graph transform, which already have a fixed point, and so we knew that, as in this morning, the graph are C1. Because they are fixed. Okay? So now, you have checked that lambda is a lamination, and the graph, so lambda is a lamination, and by induction is k minus 1. So now, when you project, you deduce that E is CK minus 1 along the leaves. And so the leaves are CK as what we wanted to do. OK? So I will now talk about another smoothness, which is a transverse smoothness in the same setting, let's say, or yeah. Maybe here, let's assume we have a global dominated splitting. So the whole manifold has a global dominated splitting. For instance, this one. It's partially hyperbolic. We know that now any point has a strong stable manifold. The strong stable manifold are coherent, so disjoint or coincide. So this is a foliation. So we have a strong stable foliation. Okay, so if F is CK, the leaves are CK. But it doesn't tell you that the foliation itself is CK. So what is a CK foliation? It means that there is a chart which rectifies the foliation, and the chart is CK. Okay, so to show that we have a smooth foliation or a CK foliation, we need a new assumption. So we say that the center is, let's say, K-bunched. If and only if there is C and lambda. So just for any x in k, in m, any iterate positive, the norm of f along e is smaller than the minimal norm of f along f, as usual, but divided also by the norm of f along f to decay and with a good contraction. So what's considered oftenly is just to be bunched in this case, just this ratio. So what's the conclusion, as you guess? Well, I don't know this statement. It's Pugh-Shub Wilkinson, maybe. So, if EC is k-bunched and well, at least f is ck, but in fact ck plus 1. Then the foliation, the strong stable foliation, is ck. Okay? So let's see that, and to see how the k-bunching appears. Just one particular case, maybe. So you see, so corollary. So if F is an anosov, C2 anosov, and EU is one-dimensional, so anosov means that M is hyperbolic, globally, and EU is one-dimensional, then the strong stable foliation, the stable foliation is C1. Why so? So you have to check the one, so you need C2 because of this, and you need to check the one bunching, the bunching, so, and so you need to check this. But since F is one-dimensional, the minimal norm and the maximal norm are the same, so it's one. And here you have a contraction. This bundle is contracted, so this condition is automatic. As an exercise, you may check that if you have a C3, so a C3 anosov on T2, which is conservative, so symplectic. Then the foliations are almost C2. They are C2 minus alpha for any alpha. Okay, so let's check now the transverse smoothness. So again, it's proved by lifting the dynamics. Because, so to prove the theorem, one has to show that the bundle E is CK. If you have a foliation already, but the tangent space is CK, then the foliation is CK. So one lifts the dynamics again to the Grassmannian. So again, L is the dimension of E. And so this is a bundle over M. So now DF is CK, because F was CK plus 1. And at any point of M, I have a space EX. So here I have EX. And so here we find a section of the Grassmannian, which is lambda. And again, we check that it satisfies a dominated splitting, but not the same as before. Lambda has a dominated partial hyperbolicity. So which one? So T lambda, tangent space to the Grassmannian of M, decompose like that, where here this space is just the tangent space to the fiber. Of the bundle. And so we know that this space is invariant. And here what we want is a space that lifts E plus F below. So we have to check that the expansion here that we computed painfully, that it is more than what happens here. So what happens here is what happens along E and F below. So the expansion along EU, so the fiber was bounded from below by it was M of DFN of F over norm of DFN of E, right? And the contraction along EC is bounded above by the norm of DF. So the norm of DF along F. Okay, so you want to show that this one is larger than this one. So if you look to this, you see that it is the one bunching, the bunching. Yeah? Minimal norm along F divided by norm over F is larger than norm along E. Okay? So we have a partial hyperbolicity and ici is K dominated by EU. Sometimes since EU is expanding, we say that ici is K normally expanded. So to check that, so we have to check what that that this is. I haven't checked on my paper. Okay, this condition, which is exactly this one. Huh? To check that, yes. Okay. So the K bunching gives the K domination. So now what to say to conclude? So we have this invariant set, which is a graph, lambda. It is partially hyperbolic. And the expansion occurs along the fibers, which are invariant. So it just tells you that the fibers are the strong, unstable manifold of the set. These are collection of leaves invariant and tangent to the strong and unstable space. So, okay. And now the fibers intersect the set just at one point. So it's exactly the condition of theorem C, which tells you that lambda is contained in a locally invariant submanifold tangent to ici. So transverse to the fibers. But lambda is already a graph. Huh? So in fact, this submanifold is just lambda. It's a submanifold. And this submanifold is K dominated. So this is a case of a lamination with a single leaf. And so lambda is a lamination K normally expanded with a single leaf. And so, and it's invariant by df, which is ck. So lambda is ck. But lambda is just the collection of tangent space E, of spaces of the bundle E. Huh? So it tells you that E is ck. And so, the foliation, so E was ES, right? So the foliation is CK. Okay? And that's all for today. So thank you.